announcing that it was a real kind of bump in the road for Mikey with his train had some engine problems there in Pittsburgh. And maybe you've gotten sure that, Joy, I apologize if I missed it, but be praying for Mikey because he was laid over back in Pittsburgh, and I think Mom and Dad were going to pick him up. So he's got some decisions to make. But we're praying for world wisdom for him, not to let this deter him. You have to have some senses. Is God putting the brakes on things, or is the devil trying to throw something to trip you up? And so we're just praying for wisdom for him. After that, I'm believing the devil's trying to trip him up right now, and God has good things for him. So let's continue to pray for wisdom, though, for Mikey. And I would ask for the kids come down front. Pastor Doug wants to show you something near and dear to my heart. I took my canoe apart to get the middle board. There's usually three boards on a longer canoe that are called thwarts, but the middle one is called a yoke, and I think most of the grown-ups there would know why this is called a yoke, right? If you've seen an ox yoking, usually there'd be two. Like if you two were oxen, stand up once. All right. If you two were oxen, there would be two curves in this, and it would fit right like that. Let's move apart just a little bit. Okay, did they look pretty good? You think you could haul something? We think Rick did. Could haul something?
Oh, yeah.
So there'd be a heavy load, and this would be hooked around your chest, and you'd pull. And the Bible, okay, you can sit down again. Pastor Doug, that's why a yoke for two oxen, that's how they pull a heavy load, because it fits on their shoulders. And for people, if they're carrying a canoe, it's still called a yoke, because Pastor Doug, this would be on the canoe, and I would take the canoe and I'd flip it up on my shoulders, and then the whole canoe is resting on one person. So I look kind of silly because I'm kind of short. So when I have a big long canoe and I'm walking with it, it's like a canoe with short legs, you know. But I hold on to this yoke. It rests on my shoulders. And I reach up and I grab the sides of the canoe, and then I can walk along carrying my canoe with the canoe yoke. And later on, I'm going to show you a little different kind of canoe yoke that makes it better. So we're going to talk about that. But Jesus' yoke, Jesus said, come and take my yoke upon you. And so Jesus was saying his teaching and his way of living and what he did on the cross for us makes life easier, makes us be able to carry life's load. So we pray we can do that. So everybody put your hand on the yoke. All right, and let's, if you all join us in the echo prayer. Dear Lord, life has troubles and distresses, and we need your help. So help us take your yoke, your teaching, Your life, live for us, and help us to live for you. Amen. Boy, these are nice prayers. Amen. But this morning, I want to share with you our message. And we've heard the phrase, you hear a lot of Jesus' words. We hear words like, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And some people don't even know that's Jesus' words, the golden rule. And we have these words, come to me, all ye who labor. And it goes on to say, and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So we know Jesus said those words, and they're comforting to us. But it's very important to know the setting of words when they're spoken. Wouldn't you agree? Like, London was being bombed, and we know Winston Churchill said, we have nothing to fear but what?
Fear.
The fear itself. Wouldn't you say that was a pretty fearful time? The whole town, London is being bombed, and then we have President Reagan, you know, goes from there before the communist wall, He says, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this, what, wall. And we know there was a great stress between communism and the Western world. So when Jesus said these words, come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest, it's important to know the context there. And it really, this, Denise Peck said, he said, every time you hear something from the Bible and someone else is preaching it, it's good because you get a different outlook on it. And I really looked at the context of these words in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28-29. But the chapter 10 and then chapter 11 set up the context for why Jesus said those words. And the chapter 10 is on Jesus' teaching. And Jesus really is letting them know what they're going to go through. And he's teaching about different types of stress. Anybody have stress from time to time? I put some stress on Joyce. Put some stress on Joy today. I apologize for that. Life throws these stressors at us. And Jesus was teaching about three kinds of stress. He was teaching about persecution from other people. He was teaching us that we should fear God, keep our relationship with God. And he was saying that even there will be division in families because of struggles in families, because of the truth, and because of what Jesus said. And I thought, well, that would be enough if just his teaching pointed out the stress. But then you read chapter 11, everything up to verses 28 and 29 are real life situations of stress and trouble. And like I said before, you all would know that certain things in life bring on real troubles and stress to us. And Jesus actually shares three lessons on three ways that stress comes upon people. And the first way is doubt. John the Baptist, who faithfully served the kingdom of God, preached righteousness, he is thrown into prison because he takes a stand against Herod's unrighteousness. Herod had a relationship not pleasing to God. He married his brother's wife and took his brother's wife. And so John the Baptist stood up against that. And because of that, John the Baptist was thrown into prison with the definite judgment that he was going to be beheaded. He was really one of the first martyrs for the kingdom of God. And can you imagine being in prison, having stood up for Jesus, the Lamb of God, stood up for righteousness, and you know you're waiting for your death? And he heard that Jesus was ministering in the area. So he sent two disciples to Jesus with a question that he had. And he said, this question was, are you the one we're looking for, or should we look for someone else? Have you ever had those doubts that nag you? Am I the right person for this job? Is God really out there? You know, I've always believed in Jesus, but now there's so many other religions I'm hearing about. So we go through doubts, and doubts cause us stress. And that's what John the Baptist went through. And Jesus had an answer for John the Baptist's question. Jesus told John the Baptist's followers, you go and tell him that the blind see, and that the lame walk, and that the good news is being preached to the poor. And don't let anyone fall away on my account. Don't let anyone lose their hope or their doubts on my account. And then he got really fired up. And I like when Jesus gets fired up. Because he said, what did you go out in the desert to see anyways? Did you go out to see a prophet? I tell you, more than a prophet. And he was talking about this because John the Baptist had the courage to take a hold of the most important thing in life, and that was living faithfully before God. He said, did you go out to see a man in soft robes? He said, no, men in soft robes, they live in palaces. John the Baptist was out there preaching the kingdom of God, preaching repentance to people and the coming of the kingdom of God. And then Jesus got really fired up, and he said, what can I liken this generation to? He said, you're like children in the marketplace. And you're saying, well, dance for us if we play you a tune. And then why don't you mourn if we play you a dirge? And to me, I'm going to say this carefully, but don't ever let someone else, we should always take advice from other people. We should always take constructive criticism from other people. But we should never let another person direct us where God alone directs us. And that's what Jesus was saying. He's saying, some of you want us to laugh and play, and some of you want us to be serious, and you don't really know what you want. So there's the stress, I would say, there's the stress about what others think about us that we deal with. And then finally, Jesus says, he starts preaching to the cities around him. He says, woe to Chorazin, woe to Bethsaida, woe to Capernaum. He says, where I've done all these works, and you have not repented. And this is the third type. There's stress from our own doubts. There's stress from other people. And then there's stress from society in general. Anybody stressed out a little bit with society right now? Can you say amen?
Amen.
How about Facebook? We might as well just have an enemies block, because you have enemies out there. Or people that act like they're enemies to you. You know, it's funny, you have friends. What if we had an enemies block? I wonder if an enemy would show up. You know, when your enemies, you know, block. How many people actually are your enemies or seem like they're against you? So I say all this to say, this is the context for what Jesus said, come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus knew that people were under a great deal of stress, so he was trying to give them an answer. And let me read this for you then. That's a long introduction, but Matthew 11, 28 and 29. So in the midst of all this, and then Jesus actually says, you know, God has to reveal this to babies because he can't reveal it to adults. So somebody that's a baby, willing to learn everything about life, can understand what I'm saying. Verse 28, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Put your hand up if that verse has helped you sometime. Amen? We've all been at those stresses and troubles in our life. And I think they really are, like we said, there's doubts of ourselves, there's the stress of, at times, of interacting with other people, and then there's the general distress of society that we're going through right now. And when all those come down on you, when doubts in yourself, when stress from other people, when stress from society in general, when it falls on you like a heavy burden, what does Jesus say? Come to me. Come to me. Come to me. I wonder how we answer it sometimes. You know, do we always come to Jesus, or do we go somewhere else? Do we sink in our doubts? Do we accept the criticisms of others or criticize others? And do we just let society overwhelm us? I can't hardly take the news sometimes, because it's just like, is there any good news in society? When all these things come upon us, do we come to Jesus, or do we go somewhere else? You know? Do you go to the fridge and eat? Some people go to the fridge when they're stressed. Emotional eating. Do you go to the steak store? You say, if I can just drown my sorrows, then everything will be alright. I'll drown my sorrows in my addictions, and somehow I won't have problems with things. Do you go to shopping? You know, some people say, I'm stressed out, I'll just go buy something. If I buy a new pair of shoes or buy a new dress or buy a new suit or buy a new camping gear. Well, now that's getting a little close to me. If you think you can buy something, in the midst of all that, Jesus said, that's not where you'll find it. Jesus says, come to me. What an amazingly audacious thing to say. For any rabbi to say, come to me. Come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden. That's the second part of it. All of us labor and are heavy laden. We all have stress. We all have troubles. I liken it to, a lost and found bin. I've said this many times in many different sermons. A lost and found bin is a great equalizer. You can have a soap glove. If it goes missing, it's going to end up in the lost and found bin. You can have an old woolen kid's mitten with holes all through it and sticky from a popsicle or whatever else. And popsicles in the winter, that doesn't make much sense, but all those things end up in the lost and found bin, right? Because they all have something in common. They're all lost. So sometimes, we can get judgmental of somebody that's really wealthy, but you know what? They have stress and trouble too. I often wonder, why is a guy in a BMW flying down the berm with a cigarette hanging out of his mouth? Does he want to go to death faster than... Doesn't he have some often think, don't you have a lot to live for because you have that? But maybe he doesn't. Maybe he's under more stress and trouble than I know. And so we all are under labor, and that's the regular grind of work. That's labor drawn out over a long period of time. That's the long hill you're climbing, if you're an oxen carrying a load. And then there's the heavy burden, the weight that's laid upon you. All of a sudden you lose a loved one or you get a diagnosis and you have that weight thrown upon you. And you wonder how you're going to make it. And you're looking for rest and you cannot find it. I liken some of this to my canoeing and stuff. Whitewater raft guides have their own language. And so they may have to get through some rapids and they'll say, paddle, paddle hard. But then they'll say, sometimes they all have all rest. So you've gotten through the dangerous spot and you're in some calmer water and you don't have to avoid a rock. And so the whitewater guide says, all rest. That means he's told you you can take a break. Or an eddy is a still place of water behind a big rock. And if to be a good whitewater canoer or kayaker or rafter, you have to be able to pull into an eddy once in a while and take a rest and take a look around. And Jesus offers to us, when we're tired from the regular work of life, when we're tired of some great burden thrown upon us, when we feel like John the Baptist and we've stood up for goodness and righteousness and we're in a dark prison awaiting our death, when you're wearied by people, don't you think Jesus kind of got wearied? He said, what can I liken this generation? John the Baptist doesn't do anything and you say he has a demon. And Jesus comes drinking and eating and calling. And I think there's a lot of room for constructive criticism. There's a whole lot of room for kindness too, amen? Sometimes I think this world has got to be such a harsh place. And the internet has made it worse. Because people still feel like they can say anything. People feel like they can spill out anything in their life. And then people feel like they can say anything as mean as they want to. Even if they feel justified. Even if you felt someone else has wronged you. What place is it of yours to write something nasty and wrong in response? I was watching a movie, gospel spiritual movie. And I never seen it before. And there's a little rough language in it. But it was called Fighting Temptations, and Beyonce, she's got an amazing voice, right? She was the choir leader for this African-American choir. But there was a church lady in the thing, and she said, are we going to have a woman like her be our choir leader? And Beyonce came up to her, and she said, let me tell you something. I thought, oh boy, she's going to go right after it. She said, in life, there is sandpaper, and there is objects that are being beautified. And she says, the sandpaper just rubs and rubs and rubs and grates and grates and grates. And you can concentrate on that, but if you're going through it, she said, just remember, for every grate that you take from another person, you're being smoothed. You're being made into something beautiful. And the sad part is, I don't want to be sandpaper in life, because all you do is wear yourself out. and people are being beautified by your frustrations. We should be more like Jesus said, and just because Jesus finally said, wisdom is proved right by her children. So the ultimate judge for you is wisdom and God and Jesus Christ. We have to rest in that. We should always take constructive criticism. We should always take that from other people. We need that in the church. Speak the truth in love. We need that. But we also need to remember to be kind, because everybody's going through more than you can imagine. Amen? You know, we all have to really think about that. And then the distress of society. You know, isn't it amazing that our doubts and criticisms from others and the stress of society, here's the good word for you. You don't have to carry it. Or at least Jesus can make it easier to carry it. And that's why he said, think of what he said in closing. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. And that's exactly the way Jesus lived his life, if you think of it. Think of Pilate. He's ready to crucify Christ. And Pilate says, don't you know I have your life in my hands? And Jesus said, you would have no power except it was given to you from on high. That's meekness. That's lowliness. That's the strength that Christ has. And so we need that kind of strength as we live our lives. Through our doubts, our stresses from other people, and the distress of the world, we need to be able to take the yoke of Jesus upon our shoulders and live by him. I told you I have two yokes. This yoke is a factory canoe yoke. It's an old town factory canoe yoke. You know, it serves a function. It stabilizes the canoe, and if I have to, I can carry my canoe with this factory yoke. But it ain't very pleasant, because it wasn't made to make the job easier. In some ways, it makes the job harder. Now, this yoke has a lot in common with the factory yoke, but there's differences, aren't there? This is made out of beautiful, this is ash, this is beautiful cherry wood. This was hand-fashioned by a craftsman in Ontario, Canada, who I would imagine carried a lot of canoes in his lifetime. Every one of you know there's certain pans that work better in your kitchen. Can you say amen? I won't say women, it might be men too. Any of you guys that swing a hammer, you know certain hammers are a whole lot better than other hammers. If you have an S-wing ripping hammer in your hand and you turn down the house, it's going to work better than a Dollar General hammer. No bad for the Dollar General. Sometimes you just need a little hammer. But sometimes you need a tool, something you need effective. And that's what this yoke is in regards to canoeing. Because I took that one off, and I put this one on my canoe. Why? Because it helps me to do the job in a better way. So when I grab a hold of my old-time canoe and I throw it up on my shoulders, I just go, whoo, that feels good. When you get your job right, doesn't it feel good? God created us to do work, but he doesn't want it always to be hard. And that's why Jesus said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. That means life is always going to be hard. But if you learn to do it as Jesus has taught us, you'll find it a lot easier. And it was interesting because Jesus said, you will find rest for your souls. That's from Jeremiah 6:16. He said, if you disregard the ancient ways, it will be difficult. But if you go in the way that God directs you, you will find rest for your souls. All you're thinking about, all you're feeling, all you're choosing will be easier. It won't be completely, you know, stressless, but it'll be easier because you carry your life, the burdens of life, with Jesus' yoke. And I thought it was interesting that The old rabbis would say, you must carry the yoke of the law. Jesus said, I have a new yoke for you to carry. And that's a relationship with me. And you know, when Jesus died, everybody knows Jesus carried his own cross to Calvary. And a lot of people think he carried a regular full cross. But most experts know that it was just the horizontal piece. Isn't that like a yoke? Jesus took up the yoke of his life and he carried it on our behalf so he could bring salvation to us. What a great blessing for all of us. Amen? Are you more excited about living now? I am. You know, I get distressed too. I have doubts and I have stresses from other people. And I give stress to other people. And I have distress about society. But I have to, in the midst of all that, I have to hear the words of Jesus, come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And in the end, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. May we learn to walk with Jesus. Amen. You bow your head with me in prayer. Dear Lord, we just pray that you would help us. And even as our last song says, to turn our eyes upon Jesus, to look away from the world. And through Jesus' life, through his teachings, which you can learn in the gospel, and through the instruction of the Holy Spirit, we can learn to live with the yoke of Jesus upon our shoulders. And our life will be easier and our burden will be lighter. And we ask that you might do that for us, Jesus, in your name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Very good.